大家请坐. If everybody can take their seats, please. Thank you very much. I appreciate the glass banging. Whoever's doing it, by all means, continue. Boy, it is hard to see up here. If I could ask you all to take your seats, please. We're going to start our post-dinner program. And I guarantee you, the faster you sit down, the less of me you'll hear. If you could, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming back up to the podium Carla Hills, the chairwoman of the National Committee on U.S.-China Relations. Thank you.
Thank you, John. I hope I've got it under control. You've done a good job and you've fed us well, and good evening once again. You know, it is my great pleasure to have the opportunity to introduce our 67th Secretary of State, Hillary Rodham Clinton, who took her oath of office on January 21, just one day after President Obama's inauguration. A graduate of Wellesley College and a graduate of Yale Law School, the Secretary earned high accolades for her work while she was in the private sector. As a lawyer, a teacher, an organizer of private organizations, and the author of two bestsellers. And in the course of her career, she has achieved an incredible number of firsts, including as First Lady of Arkansas, First Lady of the United States, the first woman to run for the U.S. Senate, and the first woman to be elected statewide in New York. Her experience gained in the Senate from her service on a variety of committees dealing with armed services, budget, health and education, and the environment, coupled with extensive travel, have prepared her well for her current position. The Secretary has been quoted as saying that our relationship with China will be the most important bilateral relationship in the world in this century. And she has demonstrated her interest in building that relationship by traveling to China on her first overseas trip as Secretary this past February. It was her suggestion to elevate the U.S. participation in the strategic portion of the U.S.-China dialogue to cabinet rank. And she has urged that we demonstrate that, in her words, the United States and China can productively work together, not only where we have bilateral concerns, but to show leadership to the rest of the world. With the G20, the APEC, the Copenhagen meetings approaching very fast, our two nations have a chance to do just that. Madam Secretary, you have a room full of people who wish you success in all of your endeavors, and we look forward to your remarks.
Thank you so much, Carla, and thanks for your leadership in this undertaking as well as so much else. It's wonderful to be here at the end of two very busy and productive days of the strategic and economic dialogue. Secretary Geithner and I were privileged to co-lead this effort, and we were especially pleased that Vice Premier Wang and State Councilor Dai were our counterparts. We believe that these very productive conversations have helped to lay the foundation for what both President Obama and President Hu called a positive, cooperative, and comprehensive U.S.-Chinese relationship for the 21st century. As part of this process, we are enlisting the full range of talent within our governments to tackle problems that spill over not just borders and oceans, but also traditional bureaucratic boundaries, which are sometimes the hardest to overcome, from climate change to trade and investment to poverty and disease. Just as no nation today can solve the challenges we face alone, neither can government work in isolation. The issues are just too varied and complex for that. So engaging the expertise, the experience, and the energy of those outside government, including the private sector and all of you here tonight, is vital to our future progress. I also am delighted that we are going to have very soon a new ambassador from the United States to China, Governor Huntsman, who will soon be, maybe even confirmed tonight, Ambassador Huntsman, is looking forward to working not only on behalf of our nation's policies, but really representing the American people to the Chinese people. We want the entrepreneurs and the innovators in both of our countries to know that we're behind their dreams and their efforts. We want people who are working to solve problems in research labs and on the front lines of innovation to know that we're looking to support their efforts. Because we think public-private partnerships are a centerpiece of the important work that we're doing to build understanding and create new avenues of cooperation. Now, I understand that Vice Premier Wang said a few words to you about the Shanghai Expo. And I want to reinforce his message. The theme for the Expo, Better City, Better Life, will present a vision of a sustainable, healthy, and prosperous world in the 21st century. It's anticipated that more than 70 million people will visit and more than 190 nations will participate. 6 months ago, it wasn't at all clear that the United States would be one of those 190 nations. But thanks to a number of you, we are on track to be able to do so, and I salute Vice Premier Wang for his leadership. He was, as some of you know, the chair of the committee for the Beijing Olympics, so if that is any indication of his organizational acuity, I think we can look forward to a very successful Shanghai Expo. And the U.S. National Pavilion will be informative, educational, and interactive, showcasing American ingenuity, looking at how we can address together global challenges like climate change and clean energy, sustainable agriculture, mass transit, health, and economic development. We are delighted that a number of leading American companies, such as GE and PepsiCo, Chevron, Marriott, Corning, and others, have signed on to be part of putting together this visionary pavilion that will showcase much of what is best about our country. There is actually a model of the pavilion somewhere around here that I urge you to take a look at. This is shameless, I know, but that's part of the job. And we have formally signed a participation contract. We have a U.S. Commissioner General, Jose Villarreal, my special representative for global partnerships, Elizabeth Bagley. Ambassador Bagley is here. We have now raised more than half the funds needed to begin construction. I have told both the Vice Premier and the State Councilor that if necessary, I will personally build it in order to get it ready by the May opening. Commerce Secretary Gary Locke recently traveled to Shanghai for the pavilion's groundbreaking ceremony. So we are on task, as they say, and Ambassador Bagley, along with her deputy, Special Representative Chris Balderson, are here tonight, obviously more than willing to answer any questions. Now, I mention this at some length because we feel very strongly that this partnership between China and the United States for the 21st century needs to be manifest in visible ways. Secretary Geithner, at the conclusion of his discussions with the Vice Premier, announced some very positive findings and commitments of moving forward on our economic recovery efforts. State Councilor Dai and I discussed literally every part of the world and have a very good understanding of how we can continue to work together. But this is all about the future. And I've told this story before, but I want to end before I have the great privilege of introducing the next speaker. State Councilor Dai and I had a wonderful, relaxing social dinner Sunday night at the Blair House, very small dinner, where we spent time just talking about everything and getting to know each other better. It wasn't about the business of two great countries trying to determine the best way forward for our people and the world, but it touched on what is important. And what is important is that Councilor Dai had just had a new grandson. And he told me with that wonderful smile that lights up his face, and we were thinking about the significance of what we were to embark on for the last 2 days. And I suggested that before every meeting, we bring pictures of our children and our grandchildren, because truly that is what this work is all about. That is what should guide us and inspire us and chasten us with respect to the decisions that we make. So that is going to certainly be a principle of participation and commitment that Councilor Dai and I intend to pursue. Because this is part of a new beginning. It is the culmination of a process begun decades ago when Dr. Kissinger was instrumental in opening the door to the possibility that then came into fruition 10 years later of normalized relations. We were so constantly thinking of Henry Kissinger over the last days getting ready for this, because his work, his courage, the risk that he took has led us in many ways to this evening. And on a personal note, let me say that since taking this job, I've relied on the wise counsel of many of my predecessors, and Secretary Kissinger has been among the most generous and thoughtful with his guidance and advice. So once again, we are grateful that he is here with us tonight as we continue to work towards something that he saw on the horizon and convinced others that it was possible to see and move toward a stronger U.S.-China relationship. Please join me in welcoming Secretary, former Secretary Henry Kissinger.
Madam Secretary, Vice Premier Wang Qishan, State Councilor Dai Bingguo, it is an extraordinarily moving occasion for me to be here nearly 40 years after the opening to China and to see a relationship that began with an attempt to deal with a common adversary, having graduated to a point and evolved to a point where the future of world order, the future economies of our two societies and of the world depend so crucially on the relationship between China and the United States. This is the eighth American administration and the fourth generation of Chinese leaders who have pursued a consistent policy that has brought us to this point. And of course, whenever a Chinese delegation comes here, it contains so many friends and so many individuals whose experiences I have seen over the last decades, that this is a guarantee for our future. There could be no stronger chairman of this dialogue than Secretary Clinton and Secretary Geithner on our side. And I'm confident that we are at the beginning of another extraordinarily creative period. Vice Premier Wang Qishan mentioned Deng Xiaoping. And one of the most moving experiences in my life was one evening when Deng Xiaoping had returned to Beijing in 1979 and explained to me at a banquet what his plans were and what he understood by reform. And I mention it only because it was a very unusual approach, and it brought us to this point because of the combination of courage and vision which characterized him and then his successors. It is my privilege this evening to introduce State Councilor Dai Bingguo. The most difficult problem of foreign policy is that one always has to act on assessments which cannot be known when one makes them. I know nobody who has better judgment, more thoughtful preparations, more patience, and more commitment to the central importance of the Sino-American relationship than State Councilor Dai Bingguo. I and many of all his interlocutors have learned an enormous amount from him. And we know that under his guidance and that of the Vice Premier, the Chinese-American delegations will begin to chart a future as innovative and revolutionary as that of their great predecessor, Deng Xiaoping. And it's in this spirit that I would like to ask the State Councilor to address this group in expressing my great personal pleasure in welcoming him here.
尊敬的格林登国务卿盖特拉财长，尊敬的基辛格博士鲁宾前财长，尊敬的希尔斯大使利伟成先生，下面我需要尊敬的这个名单就太长了，我就不念了。每次我到美国来啊， 使我最开心的一件事情之一，就是跟美国各界的朋友们欢聚一堂，畅叙友情。我第一次来美国是1986年，那个时候中国和苏联关系还没有正常化，所以我们的外长只能在联合国。 这个地方跟苏联人、苏联外长对话，那个时候不叫战略对话，关于正常关系、关系正常化的对话。我那个时候是苏联东欧司司长，我到了美国才知道为什么美国可以称为超级大国。 首先，我要感谢美中贸易委员会、美中关系全国委员会啊，和其他友好团体对王岐山副总理和我以及我们代表团所有的同事们的今天这样热情、热烈的令人感动的款待。 我呢，可以告诉大家，也算一个小秘密。王岐山副总理是京城几大名嘴之一。我这个他是很有演讲天才的，我这个就比较笨了，这嘴。他呢刚才讲了，还有一位地质学家的。 老师，我也有一位老师，我很崇拜的，就是坐在这里的，刚才在这儿讲话的基辛格博士，他是跟随尼克松总统打开中美关系大门的。 老一代美国的政治家领导人，他为中美关系的发展做出了杰出的贡献。他现在已经是80多岁高龄了，经常奔波在这个中国和美国之间，可以说。 在我心里头，他是外交问题、国际关系问题的这个智慧的化身，是中美关系一个活的百科全书。有谁可以站出来说比他更了解中美关系？我看。 很难找得到，所以我非常敬重他。从他那里可以学到很多东西。他刚才讲，从我这儿学东西，我想他是抬举我了，我不敢当，不敢当。所以我每次到美国来。 我要单独来的话，我就会先到纽约拜访他，然后再到华盛顿。这次不行了，因为我们明天要跟王岐山副总理坐一个飞机回去，所以没有机会专门在纽约拜访他了。说到战略对话，我想70年代打开。 中美关系大门的那个时候，基辛格博士同周恩来总理，啊，我们敬爱的周恩来总理，同敬爱的毛泽东主席，长时间的十几个小时、20几个小时的对话，我想那是中美第一次高水平的、高质量的战略对话。 我们现在是在学习啊，怎么呢搞这样的对话，学他们。当时没有这样的眼光，没有大致到有，是不可能去打开中美关系的大门的。我们没有今天这样，或者巨大发展的，跟两国两国人民带来巨大好处的中美关系，大家也不可能坐在这儿呢，抢今天这样高朋满座。那么这次对话究竟怎么样？大家可能关心。我今天听到的奥巴马总统权威性的评价，我也听到了克林顿国务卿的权威性的评价。刚才基辛格博士也跟我说，其他的朋友也跟我说，说美方对这次对话满意，有的说很满意，我也认为这次对话很成功，我也很满意。不知道王岐山副总理是不是同意我的意见？ 我们的对话，我觉得非常涉及的问题非常广泛。我下午跟记者朋友们讲，可能除了上月球、上火星，我们没有谈到以外，很多问题都谈到了，两国关系问题、天底下的很多问题都谈到了，但是我们没有背着别人搞什么阴谋诡计，我们谈的很深入。 很坦诚，也很有成效。这个事实证明啊，而且历史将来还会证明，两国元首在伦敦做出决定，建立中美战略与经济对话，它是非常正确的，影响将会很深远的。当然，我也想 说一下，我们现在的对话也是多年来中美之间战略对话、战略经济对话的继承发展，它继承了，但是发展了，有新的创造。那么在这两天时间里头，我天天呢， 大部分时间呢，是跟克林顿国务卿在一块儿进行了倾心的交谈。我们呢握着手，这两天不知道有多少次，我没有计算。这个我们这是第二次见面，第一次是在北京，他去北京的时候，我在中国的钓鱼台宴请他。 我当时就见他以后，我第一句话就说：“您比我在电视上看到的更漂亮。”这是发自内心的。而且我也跟他讲的，在世界上， 大国里头当国务卿的女士只有她，没有别人。她有非凡的毅力、智慧和才能。那么这是第二次我们见面，正如他也说的，我们就好像成了老朋友了。他说了一句话， 这两天我印象深刻，他说战略互信不是抽象的，我赞成这个意见。这个包括了人与人之间，我们中美之间官员官员之间相互的了解、信任、友谊和合作。 中美关系它是有具体的人，包括在座的各位，大家来做的一件伟大的事业。所以人与人之间加强沟通交流，增进友谊，非常重要。 这个，想必大家已经注意到了，昨天奥巴马总统啊，在我们开幕式上发表了一个非常重要的讲话，他谈到了，集中谈到了中美关系，我已经看了好几遍，从中我懂得的。 许多新的东西。那么，他昨天讲到，他不认为美国企图遏制中国，也不认为中国的崛起可怕。大家可以去再翻阅一下这个讲话稿，讲话。 也许同朋友们会问，你们中国人究竟心里想的什么啊？你们是不是啊什么韬光养晦，搞什么阴谋诡计啊？现在不行，将来发展的强大了，你们再来争夺世界的霸权，抢美国的位置啊？ 我可以告诉大家，可以丝毫不用怀疑，中国几代人、十几代人乃至几十代人，我们想做的事，心里想的是，要做的事，最重要的就是中国的和平发展，对内求和谐，求发展，对外求和平。 求合作，同世界各国，包括美国一起，来共同推动建设一个持久和平、共同繁荣的和谐世界。中国没有扩张称霸的这种历史传统，我们有几千年以人和为核心的政治文化传统，崇尚和为贵、亲人善邻、协和万邦。现今的中国。 我们更是不当头、不称霸，也不争霸，这已经成为我们中国的基本国策。我们呢，说话也是算数的，言行一致的。我们不输出中国的社会制度和发展道路，尊重美国人民对社会制度和发展道路的选择。你们搞你们美国式的资本主义。 我们搞中国特色社会主义，我们自己要一心一意谋发展，也乐见美国继续繁荣发展，致力于同美国的经济技术合作发展的越多越好。贸易现在3000多美元了，将来为什么不可以到30000美元？ 3万亿美元，我想将来都有可能的。我们不搞军备竞赛，我们首先要考虑的，让让我们13亿中国人日子过得好一点，住得好一点，吃得好一点，穿得好一点，住行出行方便一点。 我们不可能，也不愿意把大把的钱花在军备上。所以，中国的根本战略走向、意图对美国、对世界是可知的，是透明的，是善意的，是美国朋友们完全可以与之放心的打交道、交朋友的。 这个用不着睡不着觉啊，担心什么？ 可以放心。 是不是还有不放心的？ 我是说真话的， 说真话的， 我是诚心诚意， 至于啊， 根据我们国家， 政府的根本方针， 致力于发展， 同美国的长期稳定的， 健康的， 友好合作关系。 我的前辈也曾经参与了这项事业，我老早就从他那里听到了许多东西，听到了中美关系的重要性。那么下一阶段如何把奥巴马总统上任后中美关系的良好开局延续和发展下去，如何把两国元首 为中美关系确定的定位落到实处，把双方的美好愿望转化为发展两国关系的政策与行动，推动中美关系迈上新的台阶呢？我想，要继续把中美关系这篇大文章做好，做得更好，是不是我们双方还可以这个树立以下几个意识？一个就大局意识。 这个大局这个词儿，中国人爱用，但是翻成外文呢，就不太容易翻译了。大体的意思啊，就是就中美关系而言，这个大局就是要特别注意相互尊重彼此的核心利益，维护两国关系的长期稳定。第二是要有责任意识。 刚才国务卿女士就讲到了责任。面对日益增多和严峻的全球性共同挑战，中美一定要竭尽全力携手合作，化机遇为挑战，促进稳定和繁荣，努力让中美两国和世界上每一个家庭都生活在和煦的阳光之下。 三是要有共赢意识，在当今全球化的时代，互利共赢应当成为我们处理国与国关系、开展广泛国际合作的一个重要原则。我讲了，既然我们大家都处在一条被狂风巨浪所倾泻的这条大船上， 面临着共同的挑战，休戚与共，命运相关，那么我们就要同舟共济，追求共赢。好像美国朋友们，还是国务卿克林顿国务卿和盖特的财长写的文章里头，最近好像也提到我们共同的划这个桨。 那么下面我就要感谢一下中美友好关系的朋友们，中美友好团体和友好人士是推进中美关系不断跨越艰难险阻、迈向前进的强大力量。中美关系的每一点进步都凝聚着你们的心血，中美关系的每一个成就都浸透着你们的汗水。在新的历史时期， 抓住新的机遇，实现中美关系新的更大的发展，离不开你们的努力和贡献。中国有句话叫“众人拾柴火焰高”，中美关系更加美好的未来，有赖于中美两国越来越多的各界人士的共同参与和创造。基辛格博士刚才讲到， 这是一个创新的时代，我们要在前任的基础上，在30年的关系发展巨大发展的基础上，创造中美关系更加辉煌的未来。 最后我也想跟各位分享这个一点快乐。前天我已经跟克林顿国务卿呢提前告诉他了，说我这个一个月前整整一个月前，当上爷爷了。我没有当上爷爷之前有人告诉我说那不一样啊，当上爷爷以后，我想更多的是责任，不是快乐。每当我抱着可爱的小孙女的时候，来之前那一天早晨我还专门去看了她。 看中了天真无邪的小脸，我总在想，我们应该把一个什么样的世界留给我们的子孙后代？我们应该为他们创造一个怎样的未来？我相信在座的每一位都和我一样，希望我们的孩子们远离战争、饥饿、灾难。 和疾病都能在蔚蓝的天空下呼吸着新鲜的空气，在明媚的阳光里健康快乐的成长。让我们中美两国人民携起手来，让全世界的人民携起手来，为实现这个理想做出我们的努力。最后，我还要衷心的感谢。
克林顿国务卿、盖特的财长和国务院美国参与这次对话的朋友们，还有没有参与这个对话、关注支持这个对话的朋友们，表示敬意，表示衷心的感谢。感谢奥巴马总统，感谢胡锦涛主席，他们对我们对话的高度重视。 关心、支持和指导。下一次对话应该在北京进行。我们欢迎你们，欢迎克林顿国务卿、盖特的财长和美国朋友们到北京去。我们就担心我们能不能够像你们这样，这次我们是。 这受到的这样热情的接待，这样精心的安排，但是我们会努力去做。最后，我想我们只要共同努力，坚持不懈，我们。 就能够创造中美关系更加美好的未来。谢谢大家，我讲的笨嘴多了一点，谢谢。Thank you, thank you. 谢谢。
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
That's wonderful.
Mom,
just wonderful. Councilor Dai, that was an inspiring and wonderful speech, and we agree with you. That the Vice Premier is an outstanding speaker, but you have persuaded this audience that you too are an outstanding public speaker, and we're grateful for your remarks. Let me say to all of you who have participated tonight, thank you so much for being with us. And I particularly want to thank the four leaders of the Strategic and Economic Dialogue. I would also like to wish our Chinese visitors a safe journey home. And to get them started in the right direction, I would ask all of our guests to stay seated just for a few minutes so that our two guests, the Vice Premier and the State Councilor and their delegation, can leave together and so they have an easy exit from our event. And I thank you one and all.